What?
Hello, hello, hello. It is
Hello.
Monday night.
Yes,
It is Women's History Month too. Happy women's, all the ladies out there doing something big, or if you're just a woman, it's Women's History Month. So let's just celebrate. And this is Ladies Night. And so to kick off Women's History Month, my first night being on the air for the month of March, I have Miss Ashley Brooks here.
hello,
And
everybody.
she is a real estate agent, correct?
Correct, with Long and
Yes,
Foster.
with Long and Foster. And you actually did start your own business that we'll definitely get into talking about later on,
Okay.
correct? Yep. Okay. So you want to tell them the name of your business
It's
that you
A. Brooks
started?
Estates LLC.
Okay. And how can they find you on social media?
On social media, the Instagram is A. dot Brooks Estates. Facebook, the same thing, A. dot Brooks Estates. And contact number is 240-602-5346. That's my cell number, and the office number is 301-249-1600.
Okay, all right, and we're gonna look at each other. All right, so you've been doing real estate for 8 years,
No, I started working at a real estate law firm,
for eight
and I was
years,
in real estate law firm
in
for
the
about
real estate
8 years.
industry for 8 years. Okay, and then your mission is to tell people how they can create financial stability and freedom
Yeah, through the home buying
through the
process.
home buying process. Okay, so we definitely gonna get into that. It's definitely a topic that is very key and pertinent right now because we're right here at tax season. Right, and when a lot of people make financially irresponsible decisions,
Decisions, yes, like taking
and
your tax refund and getting a car note.
yeah,
That is
that's
not the
what
goal in life. Do not
see.
take your
Do
tax
you know
refund and
somebody
get a
that's
car
done
note.
that?
No, not a lot of people that take their tax
Oh
refund and get a car note.
my
Don't
gosh,
take your tax refund and get a car note. That
yeah,
is
don't do
not
that,
the goal
right?
in life.
Especially if so, that's just don't even make sense. So basically, they use the tax refund. I've heard of people, I guess, as a down payment,
Yeah, that's your down payment, but
and
now you have
yeah.
a car note every month
Right,
for the
that
next
you
5 years.
probably couldn't have carried before you got,
Exactly.
yeah, okay. So, look, so can we look? So, let me tell you, we got this little bell here. And anytime somebody says something that's real important,
You ring
excuse
the
me,
bell
we ring the bell. So, you just said, don't take your tax refund
and get a car
and
note.
get a car note. There you go.
Not today.
That is going to be, look, what is it? Line, guideline number one.
Guideline number one.
Guideline number one. Okay, I like that. So, before we get more into the topic, because I'm sure it'll be more little nuggets, and we'll use this bell quite often throughout the show tonight. Let's go ahead and touch on this topic since we missed last Monday. I wasn't here last Monday. We need to talk about this Remy Ma, Nicki Minaj situation. Like
I've seen
and.
this though. I don't listen to rap music like that. I'm a country and rock music type of person. I really feel Remy Ma is a battle rapper.
Okay.
Nicki Minaj is going to appeal to the general public.
The
So the group,
pop and all
yeah,
that
like
kind
the
of
pop, like
stuff.
the group that Remy Ma is reaching, she's reaching battle rappers, which is not a large, in my opinion, it doesn't reach a large amount of people in regards to selling records. Nicki Minaj is going to sell records regardless. And her replying to her would just be giving Remy Ma more shine, personally.
I agree.
So you guys should just listen to country music and rock music. You wouldn't have no
Country
beef with nobody.
music and rock music. Which, what was the station that you recommended?
98.7.
Okay, for the country and rock music. So if you don't know anything about country and rock music, like I don't, then go. I think now that I've listened to you and then Donnell talk about it, I'm going to maybe tune into
It's
98.7
really
now.
amazing
Because that's
music.
definitely not on my station. I got like 104.1, 102.3, everything else. You know how you kind of lock your stations
Yeah.
in. But 98.7 was not one of those stations.
It's an
But now I feel
amazing
like I need to add
station.
that to my list.
I'm telling you, they tell like the music tells stories. I mean, you
It
don't feel
does.
angry when you listen to the
That's
music.
true.
And I
That's
really feel
true.
like a lot of today's music makes people angry, or they make them want to live like this facade lifestyle that you really can't portray in a normal life. You know what I
There
mean?
you
Like in a
go.
day-to-day life, you're not gonna you can't pop bottles every day of your life.
No,
It's
you
not
don't.
realistic.
Exactly.
It's
A
not,
party
yeah,
life.
it's not,
Yeah,
you don't
that
live a party
whole.
life. That's not reality. So
Or it shouldn't be reality.
shouldn't be reality. It's
Yeah,
some
because
people's
then I was going to
reality
say, because if
that,
it
you know, it
is, and especially at
retract
a certain
that.
age.
It is some people's reality.
Yes. And at a certain age, though, because do you see that sometimes just kind of question? Because there's somebody now, I've seen somebody on social media on a page, and the young ladies was like bent over. you know, when her hand was on the other lady. And it's like, but we like 30 now. Like, I kind of, you know, you think yeah, you do that when you were a teenager.
Nothing wrong with turning up. I mean, everyone turns up. You know what I mean? Everyone wants to have a good time. Everybody wants to party. But I think it's a time and place for it. I think with social media being so evident, you know, you expose so much of yourself.
Yes,
and of course, other people get to form opinions. Mm-hmm. And, you know, some people are like, who cares what other people's opinions
right.
mean? So. But at some point in time in life, you have to be like, okay, I'm, you know, when is it time to grow up?
Yeah.
When is it time to really, you know, do stuff? But then it also reflects back to people's priorities and people's goals. Everyone has different goals in life. Not everybody wants to have, you know, the typical stable go to work lifestyle. You know, I'm gonna save my money so I can travel. Some people just want to live in that moment, and there's nothing wrong with living for the moment, because a while ago, like, my hashtag was live for the moment and enjoy your memories. And literally, you just live for the moment. Whatever happens in that moment,
just enjoy it.
You enjoy the memories as they come along. But at and some
you
point
should
in time,
have that. I think it's a balance. I don't think it's bad to think like that, but you still gotta kind of have a. It's a gotta balance. Be a little bit of a balance.
I definitely
I think.
Balance is a major.
Because living too much in the moment, then of course, and we're gonna talk about this in the show as well tonight. You're not preparing for the future. How much are you preparing for the future if you're only living for right now?
Right.
I think I came off of that too, like a few months ago.
Stop
like, oh, I'm going to the wall. I'm going to go to Vegas. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that, girl. And then I ran that credit card bill app. Yeah. And
now
I'm
you
paying
pay
for it.
Money.
Look, and
look
now I'm
you.
Paying for it. See? So, lesson learned. Lesson learned. So, but yeah, definitely. So, okay, I agree with you as far as just going back a little bit to the Remy Ma and Nicki Minaj situation. The bottom line is I like Remy, not so much her music, but I like her on a personal note. You know, seeing her on Love & Hip Hop and then seeing her and Papoose's relationship and, you know, them being so open and honest with what they're going through. I like Remy on a personal note. Would I buy her CD? Like, I didn't even know she's had, like, 3 albums, I think. Or 3 mixtapes or whatever. I had no idea. But I like have every Nicki Minaj CD and has even gone to her concert. You know, I took my niece to the Pink Print tour at the Jiffy Loop Center that you all had mentioned before. What was that, 2015? So, but I wouldn't have never known all of that about her. So anyway, I digress. I have a little skit, speaking of music. And since you gave me a nice gift at the beginning of the show, again, thank you so much. before we came on air, I want to give you a chance to get a gift, and I'm going to probably give it to you regardless, but I just want to have a little bit of fun.
Okay.
So you do listen to hip-hop, right?
I do listen to hip-hop.
Okay. Well, I'll give you a clue. So this song did come out a few years ago. It's a rapper, and then there's a famous female in the video as well. So I just want to give you these words, and I'll have you read them and look at the pictures. And then think of a line or a certain section in that song from what you're looking at in the picture and see if you can guess it. Okay? All right, and then you can hold it up and show our viewers. Insecure.
Mm-hmm. Which a lot of people
are. That's a word. Insecure. That's a word for the, I think we all have some
insecurities.
Absolutely.
The school.
Secure.
Sophomore.
Is it another card behind that? Oh, no. Mm-hmm. Sophomore.
Career.
Mm-hmm.
Get you a career, not a job.
There's a difference. We're going to talk about that too. Picture of somebody doing hair. We'll see.
Shoes.
Air Jordans.
Peer pressure.
Alexis.
Yeah.
It's my name too. Long hair.
Weave.
Mm-hmm. Is it coming to you now?
No.
The song not coming to
Eve.
You? Donnell, is it coming to you?
You got it? Single black female. Shout out to all the single black females.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Addicted to retail.
It's
Kanye West. I know what the song is.
Yes. You cast it.
I'm right, though. I don't know the name of the song, but I know exactly what you're talking about.
It all falls down.
Yes. I like that song, actually.
So that line right there, though. Because that's like one of my, what did he say? Insecure. He said, tell me that ain't insecure.
Yeah.
The concept of school seems so secure. Sophomore, 3 years, ain't picked a career. She like, I said, I'll just stay down here and do hair. Because that's enough money to buy.
Named the daughter Alexis.
Yes, all of that,
that's
right?
Cute.
So that kind of just ties into the conversation, you know, about finances and our ignorance and stuff when it comes to finances. You know, I was up printing this stuff out earlier. Because I just like to be funny and cute. So I'm glad you guessed it in down there. I'm glad you guessed it. That means I had good clues. Yay! Point for me. So, but let's go ahead and jump into this topic because I feel like it's so many levels to this conversation. Like, it's like, where do you start? But let me go ahead and I want you to tell us more about yourself and what it is that you do and what your passion is. That's okay. We know what your passion is. Just tell us about yourself, and I'm sure it'll flow to talk about what it is that you do on a bigger scale, bigger level.
On a bigger scale, ultimately, my goal is to show people in general, but specifically single mothers, that, you know, it's more to life than just living in a box and being, like, and complacent and being, you know, jumping from place to place. I feel like when you do have a child or you have kids, having a home for them is a major key. And I grew up in foster care, so I lived in a bunch of different places and different places here, and I was moving here, and I had to make new friends this place, and I had to make new friends that place. And I feel like it plays a role on kids mentally, because they always have to start over. So why rent somewhere, you know, and pay? When you're renting, you're paying somebody else's mortgage plus giving them extra residual income. You can take that same money that you're paying in rent and buy a home. Mm-hmm. And granted, we're not always ready to buy.
Yeah,
I get that. That's a major, you know, a buying a house is probably going to be your biggest investment. It's
absolutely. And not something you should make haphazardly.
Ever make. Mm-hmm. So it's like, where do you start?
Yeah,
how do you get to that process? Mm-hmm. The first step is to get pre-approved.
Mm-hmm.
You can't. No, even if you like, you know, I have bad credit, or I think my credit is messed up, or I have this on my credit, or I'm working to build my credit. To me, those are all procrastinating comments. Mm-hmm. Those are all blocks or like works, really? Because you can have messed up credit, and granted, but until, even if you get pre-approved and you get denied, at least you know what it is that you need to do to
That's
get your
true.
Credit started.
That's true. I will say that.
You see what I'm saying? Like,
you know where to start.
You can't start somewhere if you don't know where you're starting from.
That's true.
You can't, you could be trying to get something off your credit that's not even having an effect on your approval.
Okay.
Whereas if you get denied, then, you know, you'll get a letter of explanation for your denial, and you'll know, like, okay, I need to clear X, Y, and Z. Or I need to pay back X, Y, and Z. Or I need to do X, Y, and Z in order to, you know, potentially get approved. But until you get pre-approved, you won't know if you're approved or not.
Okay. I have a question real quick. Because this was something, and then being as though you are a real estate agent, and then for those of you like myself out there watching, listening, who have school debt, you know, at one point, I'll say just a couple years ago, I actually was in the process of trying to buy a house, and they didn't take the school loans into consideration.
Mm-hmm.
Right? That wasn't a factor. Fast forward a year later, all of a sudden that's a factor. So when I go to try to get pre-approved, whereas I was pre-approved for $150,000 the year before, I'm no longer approved for anything because then now they say my debt to income ratio is too high.
Yeah, your
because
debt
they're now factoring in the student loans. So what's the suggestion, or, you know, what are some of the, because I think that's probably one of the biggest obligations student that loans. People, you know, feel, you know, yeah, will block them from being able to get approved.
I would say, with student loans, and I can't speak too much on it because I don't have any student loans.
God bless your heart.
I don't have any. I do know, and I just recently learned this speaking with somebody. You know when they give you your refund, your student loan refund at the end of the year, you get like a refund back from when you get it.
Like that.
Mm-hmm. That refund is not yours. You need to pay that money back. So when you get $9,000 or you get $10,000 and you're like, oh, I got $10,000.
You're going to owe that money back
on the back end of your loan. So if you have that extra $10,000, you wasn't going to have it anyway.
So
you might as well take that money and give it back to them because you're going to owe it anyway. But the biggest thing I can say with student loans is make sure you pay them on time.
Mm-hmm.
Like, make sure you pay your student loans.
To show that you...
On time, like that.
Just like any other bill.
Just like any other bill. And again, like, I don't have student loans, so I can't speak too much in depth in it.
Mm-hmm.
I just learned recently that refund that they give you at the end of the year or at the end of the semester, you have to pay that money back. It's not your money, and a lot of people don't know that. So when it comes time for their loan to be done with, And, you know, and they're finished school, they're not taking classes anymore. They're like, wait a minute, where did this extra $40,000
and the interest and stuff like that.
Yeah, it came back from you.
And that's what I did. I took some of the money and, you know, I didn't, one time I took some of the loan money and paid off another loan. Like, I had a personal loan at first, you know, for school. So I did take that because that actually hit my credit hard when I was trying to go through the home buying process. But that's a good point that you made, because when I first was going to do it, I tried to get a pre-approval and they did see some things on my credit. And I was able to go fix some of those things. And in a few months, I was able to get pre-approved. Mm-hmm. So, you know, like you said, but had I not started the process and sat down with a lender and pulled my credit report, I wouldn't have known, you know, how to bring it up those few, because I was only a few points away, because I think at the time it was, what, a minimum of 640 that you needed for that particular program?
Right now it was like 620.
I heard that they did lower it. And
yeah, I mean, if you don't get pre-approved, you won't know. Mm-hmm. Like, I have people come to me all of the time, like, hey, you think I can afford a $400,000 house? Like, I don't know what you can afford, unfortunately. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, I would love to sell you a $400,000 house. Like, but I can't, you know what I mean? You won't know what you can get until you're actually ready to sit down and take that step and say, okay, here's all of my information. And I mean, a lot of people don't have the basic stuff that you need to even get pre-approved. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, you need your bank statements. You need bank statements. Okay. You need your W-2s, your tax refunds for the last 2 years. Mm-hmm. Pay statements. Just stuff like that. People don't keep their pay statements.
They don't
anymore.
Keep their stuff.
And you, that's stuff that you have to have. Like, you have to
401k,
have 401k, like if
all
you
of
pay
that
into
kind
a 401k,
stuff.
If you pay into an IRA. Mm-hmm. Like, those are like basic stuff that you need to have on hand, like, even before you go to a lender. There's no point in going to a lender just for them to turn you around.
Right. And so just have everything that
you just have everything front. Together. And Long & Foster actually has an in-house lender in our office that we work with. It's called Prosperity Home Mortgage. And she's really good. She's really quick.
Oh, it's one person.
It's more than just one person. Okay. She works, like, in our office. Okay. So, like, if you were to walk into the office tomorrow, like, hey, I have all of my
you
stuff.
Have somebody
she
there
can get
right
you,
there.
Yeah, she can get you, you know, pre-approved or let you know, you know, you got denied because X, Y, and Z, whatever the case may be. But, yeah, until you're ready to actually take that step, and the first step is getting pre-approved. Mm-hmm. Even if you think you're going to get denied.
Okay.
Get pre-approved.
Would you say maybe also, so in line with trying to work on balancing your money and then getting pre-approved, would you say it's also good to kind of start saving ahead of time as well? Because some people also have run into an issue of the down payment.
Not having the money for the down
payment. Yeah, the earnest interest money, all of that stuff, the inspections,
the appraisals. It's definitely not a cheap process, but when you get paid, 20% of your check goes to a savings account.
20%.
Not an account that you go into and dip in when you buy.
That's what touchable
or something where you'll get like a penalty if you take the money out. I know I have one for me and I have one for my son. So if I decide that I want to splurge one day, I have to reconsider because I'm like, do I really want to pay the bank, you know, X amount of dollars
for being able to
take the money out. Mm-hmm. So 20% of your check, and I get it. A lot of people live paycheck to paycheck.
Yeah.
So saving 20% of your check may seem like a lot, but it's not. Mm-hmm. It's really not. If you get paid $1,000 and you take 20% of that $1,000, which is what, $200, you put $200 away every paycheck. That's $400 a month.
Mm-hmm.
You know, 400 times 12, you're at like $4,800 for the year times X amount of years. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And of course, you know, you get raises, you get bonuses, you get extra money. You know, save 20% of anything that you have. And at the end of the year, it will
add up.
It will add up. Mm-hmm. And even if, like, when I started saving and at one point in time, I didn't know what saving was. I didn't have no comprehension of the dollar or, you know, what it meant to just spend it all. It's money. I'm going to get it right back. But in reality, you're not going to get it right back unless you have some type of residual income that's going to. But if you work a regular 9-to-5 and you work 40 hours a week and you get a paycheck every 2 weeks, you're not getting anything right
back.
Right. That money that you spent is gone. You're not going to get it back. It's gone.
And they say you spend it like it's on trees. Like
you know, spending $20 here or spending $40 here, it adds up.
Mm-hmm. I like that 20%. I was thinking about that. Now, quick question, and I mean, did I got you? Oh, okay. Because I actually had a young lady, I posted on my Facebook page earlier, and she said that her issue is that she'll save, but then she'll turn right around and spend what she saves. So, it's, you know, like,
you gotta have separate accounts. Like, for example, I love to travel. Like, if I could just travel every weekend, I would go somewhere new every weekend. I promise you I would. That's a separate account. That's a separate budget. Okay. That's in your budget. You know, if you have your savings of 20%, then you know what I mean? That's just your savings for 20%. That doesn't include anything that you want to buy or anything extra. That's just, that's what you're saving for the year, period. You're not touching it. If you want to go on a trip, if you want to buy, that's a whole nother budget. That's a whole nother account. That's a whole nother, you know what I mean? And a lot of people don't like having a lot of accounts, but I don't like to co-mingle money.
Yeah, I do.
So, you know, I have one account for savings, one account for bills, one account for personal. And in that way, at the end of the year, you can really track your spending.
And your business, right?
Yeah, and my business account.
I just opened up a business account, too.
If you own a business, you should not be commingling your money with your personal money. Because at the end of the year,
you never lie. Tax time.
Tax time comes. You're going to have a lot of explaining to do when you're saying that you've only made X amount of dollars and you're trying to claim these losses and you don't have nothing to prove because all of your money is commingled into one account. So, open up a business account is it's major. Very, very important. Even like for people that want to buy, you know, that want to buy commercial spaces. If you have a business and you want to get like a spot like this and you want to open it up under your business name, you can't do that unless, you know, you have your business account, you have your Schedule C's, you have all of the information that you need to prove that you're actually a business owner.
Right.
You know what I mean? And that's like a whole nother conversation and a whole nother outline.
That's what I was just going to say. I was like, how to start a business and all of that stuff.
And it costs a lot of money. I mean, it's not cheap. It's like, not. For people to say,
because you have an LLC too, right?
I have an LLC now. So for people that say, you know, I'm going to get into real estate and make a lot of money, you know, we all want to get into real estate and make a lot of money, but it also costs a lot of money, like marketing, just building clientele, gas, getting out there. Like, it's building a business in general just is not, it's not cheap at all. And like, I just learned that. Like, I have a newfound respect for hairstylists and nail technicians. You know how they charge you? They'll be like, you know, you have a $20 booking fee. Like, to book with me, you got to pay a deposit.
But the cancellation.
And it's
a
cancellation. I used to be like, well, for what? I'm going to come. But that's their time. And it's like, you know, I will sit in front of a house for 45 minutes and wait for somebody to come see your house. But now, you know what I mean? Like,
Do they cancel?
Sometimes they cancel. Sometimes they don't cancel. It's like, at the end of the day, I still don't sat there. You know, I don't get paid by the hour. So it's like, when you have a business, it kind of makes you really think realize and have a newfound respect for people in their time.
Like, that's,
you know,
true.
You tell me to
that's
be
true.
Somewhere
time
at 9 o'clock,
is money.
I'm going to be there at 8:30. You know what I mean?
But you was here early tonight. Right. I don't know. That's what I'm saying. I'm like, speaking of, you was here earlier. Beat me here.
Time is very important. You never know what somebody has to do with that time.
That's true. That's true. And I respected it. I seen the message. I was like, okay, I'm coming. She done beat me here. But no, that's a good point, though. And you're right, because you don't realize how much goes into a business. You know, websites and, you know, how many things. Like, you can write certain things off, but you do have to be smart about it.
Yeah.
You know, so it's definitely. So I was, so the conversation, so about saving, so 20%, I like that. And then what else would you say is some things that, what is it about, like, the credit card? Can we talk about that as far as, like, credit card balances? Because aside
balances,
from the student loans, of course, next month, monster is credit card.
30% of your
available balance. Okay.
And it's 30% of your available balance. You know, sometimes you always have to, you know, use more, but you never want to max out your credit card. That's not the goal in life. You don't want to do that. They give you $1,000 limit. That doesn't mean go spend $1,000. You know, but when they look at it, or what affects negatively on your report is when you're over that 30% range.
Okay.
When you're using,
because somebody said 20, but it's
30.
The rule of thumb is 30.
Yeah, rule of thumb is 30. Okay. But when you get into the 50, 60, you know, 70, 80, 90 percentile of using your available credit, then it doesn't look good. And it also doesn't look good to pay your credit card down and then go max it out again. You know,
why do they look at it negatively when you pay it off anyway? Period.
Because now, like, you don't have an open balance and you're not showing that you can pay something on time consecutively every month. So even if it's just $25 that you're paying every month, it's still showing that you're responsible enough, you know, you have enough credit to keep paying something, paying it down consecutively. Just like they never say, you know, get a credit card and pay it off to zero, because you didn't show them that you can make payments over the course of a month. You know what I mean? Okay. So if I go get a credit card tomorrow and I have a $500 balance and I spent $500,
turn around and pay it off,
and the next month I pay $500 and I didn't show anything.
So it's never really, because I always wondered that, like, how long is it okay to have it open before you decide you're going to pay it off?
You know? Want to leave your credit cards open, even if you're not using them. You know what I mean? Like, even if you're not using them, you want to leave it open because you want to build credit. You want to have years on your credit history. Mm-hmm. Like, how long have you had your accounts open? They look at stuff like that. So you don't want to open an account, pay it off, and then say, I'm closing it out, period.
Okay.
That's not going to help your credit. Okay. Yeah, but if you pay it off, and you just leave it open on your account, then
it shows an open
credit. It shows an open credit.
Good standing and all of that stuff.
The longer you have it open, the better it looks.
Okay. So that's good. So that's some good tips. Okay. So what else can we, talk about the financial literacy and then how people can get better with that? Because I know for me, and I had posted this on my Facebook page earlier today, I said, you know, at 29 years old, my dad, I'm a child of three, and it's all girls. And my dad says all the time, hey, I showed you how to make money, but I didn't show you how to save it, you know, how to properly invest it, you know, how to spend it a little bit more wisely. So would you say that financial literacy is something that should probably be taught, especially in the Black community, I feel like, a little earlier on, so that by the time we get to be old enough where we're actually actively working and making money, you know, we can... you know what to do with it and teach the young people, you know, how to spend and how to save, you know, like,
that rule of thumb, like when I get paid, my son gets paid. When I get my check, my son gets
paid. Do you give him an allowance?
No.
Oh.
I don't give him an allowance.
Okay.
No.
So he...
Because he's just going to swipe my card anyway. But no, I do put his money into a separate account for him.
Okay.
Because we were discussing earlier, I feel like the first option is when they turn 18 to put them out, get out, you gotta go. Mm-hmm. Whereas other cultures, they stay at home until you're stable, until you're ready to be on your own, until you're financially stable. So no, when my son turns 18, my first thing to him isn't going to be get out, but my first thing to him will be, here's a foundation for you to start off
there
on.
There you go.
You know, I feel like as a parent, I owe you that. My responsibility to give you a foundation. And I feel like a lot of us lack foundation. In lacking foundation, you know, we get out here and we just do random things that affect us in the long run.
Because you just don't know any better.
It's not like you're dumb or anything like that. You just don't have that foundation, and you don't have anybody that's, you know,
teaching you and showing you.
And honestly, my son's father's parents, they taught me that. His mother taught me that.
Oh, okay.
When his father passed away, you know, it was like, she used to make me give her $200 a month. And I used to be like, what am I giving you $200 a month for? You don't need my $200 a month. Oh. But when it was time for me to leave, she handed me a check and was like, here's your foundation. Here's your foundation. And I've been able to build off of that foundation.
That's
so good. I think, you know, being a parent is a major key. Like, you have to have a foundation for your kids.
Okay.
So when you get paid, your kid gets paid.
Mm-hmm.
So if you can't save 20%, but you can save 10%, the 5% goes to you, 5% goes to your kid.
Okay.
You know what I mean? So like, if I save 20%, 10% goes to me, 10% goes to him.
Mm-hmm.
And in that way, when he does turn 18, he's not out here like, the first thing on his mind is, oh, I need to get a job.
Yeah,
or,
I don't
I need
have
to help
money.
My mom pay
right.
my bills,
and all that stress
pay her
that
bills.
Come along
or,
with
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, kids shouldn't have to feel like it's their job to pay their parents' bills.
An adult. So
you know what I mean? Because you're an adult and they're a kid. And I feel like a lot of kids don't get to have a childhood anymore because they're too
burdened
with seeing their parents struggle. And, you know, I'm blessed and I'm thankful that I don't have to show that to him. And not everybody has that.
Yeah.
But even if you struggle, the parents
shouldn't have to, because it's funny you mention that, because I know someone who's about 26, 27, and she was telling me back when she was younger, her parents would come to her and talk about the bills. And I'm thinking, why? Like, why are they coming to talk to you about the bills and making her feel guilty? Like, she would purposely stay out of the house so she didn't burn up the electricity bill because her parents was constantly complaining to her and her brother, you know, about the bills. And it's like, so like you said, having those grown up, you know, problems and burdens placed on a child, it's just like, you know, so I like the fact that you said that you don't do that to your son, you know.
Yeah, you shouldn't. I mean, of course, if they ask you something, you'd be like, no, I don't have the money. Mm-hmm. But to burden a kid with paying bills. Mm-hmm. And I feel like a lot of us, when we turn 18, that's the first thing. Even like with, you know, young Black males, that's their first thing. Like, I gotta help my mom pay the bills, or I need to, you know, do this so I can help my mom pay her bills. And I just feel like you're the child. It's my responsibility, if I can, as a parent, to provide you with a foundation. Mm-hmm. And a foundation is a major key to me. Mm-hmm. It's a major key to success for anybody. I mean, when you build a started business, what do you start it on?
Right.
A foundation.
Mm-hmm.
So as a child, they need a foundation.
Yeah,
like,
they
need a
start somewhere.
Yeah, that'll go over to generation to generation.
That's what I was gonna say.
You
kind of creating a legacy right there.
A generation of savings.
Yeah, no, because
you see what I'm saying?
Because they learned it early. So some of the comments on the Facebook page, real quick, because we don't want to. So someone agreed, and I like this, and then a few people liked it too. Said that she believes. I do not want to butcher her name. Miss Phillips. I'm going to call you Mrs. Phillips. I'm so sorry because I do not want to mess your name up. I'm gonna have to find out again how to pronounce your name correctly. But I see you watching. Thank you so much for tuning in. But she said that she feels like it should be a requirement in high school, credit and budgeting money. That should be like a required class.
I definitely agree with that. I 100%. I mean, I think about the stuff that they taught me at school. I don't know.
Especially if you went to school. Did you go in PG County?
Yeah, I went to
Like PG County schools, they like, man, if we ain't learned nothing else, we learn how to play spades, how to skip class. I used to leave school sometimes.
You know, A squared plus B squared equals C squared. I don't know why that has stuck with me for so long. But that's what you remember. But if they would have taught me that when I turn 18, I'm going to get a bunch of credit card applications in the mail and pre-approvals in the mail, or how to fill out an application. Or how to fill out
a resume,
yeah, or how to apply for anything. They don't teach you none of that. And I really think that is something. That's really good. That is something.
That you should. Because actually, this was a little Hispanic guy that I know, customer of mine from, you know, my job. And he was saying that his daughter, who's in the eighth grade, and I don't know where they go to school at. I assume it might be Montgomery County, you know, maybe something like that. But said that the child came home and said, "Dad, I apologize." And he said, "Well, what are you apologizing for?" You know, it was just so random. And she said, "For coming to you and always asking you for stuff." She said that in school, they actually walked them through, like, bills. Like, gave, like, a mock assignment. And gave them, like, a little paycheck with some little play money and said, "Okay, this costs this and this costs that." And then to look at that and see that, she said, "I didn't even have enough, Dad." You know, like, to pay for. And now she's in eighth grade, getting that concept, you know.
Son did something like that. They gave him like a bank card or something. They took him somewhere. He goes to school. I don't know if he goes to these schools or Maryland schools, but that's little practical stuff
like that, because sometimes, and I learned that because I have nieces. I don't have my own kids just yet, but I know I think about how when my sister will say something, it's like right. I'll come and say it, and it's like I'm speaking. Number one, I'm a little younger, you know, so I'm kind of closer to their age. So I'm speaking from practical, real life experience. It seemed like for young people, and then you said your son is 9, right? Don't it seem like they're able to relate more when you kind of like make it realistic for them? You know, like kind of like connect the dots, so to speak. Not just from a teacher.
I have to connect everything with football. If it's not football, he don't comprehend it. But if I put it in football terms, and he's like, "Oh, okay,"
he gets it because that's what he likes. So you just gotta meet them where they are, basically. But no, I think that's definitely a good point. And then the same Mrs. Phillips, she said that she missed the part where we were talking about fixing your credit and stuff. So can you just say some quick, you know, pointers real quick? Can we recap real quick about credit cards and credit card debt?
Yeah, so like with credit cards, and again, I'm not no credit
counselor or something.
I just would say if you have a credit card, try to pay your credit card down to 30% of its available balance. If you have student loans, pay them on time, pay them off if you can. I mean, take your tax refund and pay your student
loans. That's what I said I plan to do. I just need to get some bigger tax refunds.
We did say don't take your tax refund and get a car note. That's something you don't want to do in life at all, ever.
And would you say also try to pay more than the minimum balance?
Yeah,
pay more than the minimum payment due.
When you're making that minimum payment, you're not paying anything but interest. You're never paying your principal.
Yeah.
And then for people that do have, like, car loans, if you're looking at, like, pay your car loan off quicker. Mm-hmm. When you make an extra payment, make sure you call them and tell them this payment is for principal only. Don't apply any of that money to interest, because what they will do is take that money
and put it to the interest first. And then if it was something left, they put it on the principal. And that's why the balance never goes down. Okay, so can we say that again? Say so when you make
it. When you want to make an extra payment, like if your car note is $250 a month, and you're like, you know what, I got an extra $150. Let me make this $150 go to my, towards my car. Don't just make a regular payment.
Okay. Call
specify like this money is strictly for principal. Because that's what makes your balance go down. Is your principal, not your interest.
Okay.
And when you're making a minimum payment, you're making that minimum payment towards the interest. You're just paying your interest for the month. You're not paying anything that you really owe. That's just the money that you were going to give them anyway because they loaned you the money.
I like that. Okay. So that's a good point. Okay. So I hope you all heard that, because I didn't even know that. So I know you mentioned that in reference to the car note, but what about, I'm thinking it's the same for a credit card too, right? So just make sure that when you're making payments and you're really trying to pay your balance down, I'm just going to recap this because that, like I said, that's news for me. Like, I have never heard that. So make sure that you call the company and tell them that you want to make a payment toward the principal balance and not toward the interest. Because if you make the extra payment, they're just going to take that money in interest, and then you never make a dip in your principal and what you actually owe. That is awesome. Okay, great. So that's good. So let's do the phone lines, just in case there's anybody. We got a few minutes into the show still left over. How's everybody looking on your end? Because this is good information right here. I'm loving this. So look, so this is just like to talk to you all about basics about finances and stuff. And then would you want to come back on? Like, we can maybe bring Miss Brooks back another time to talk more about, the real estate, like in fully in more detail about buying a house. But I feel like this was a good time to just talk about the basics and finances and saving and paying off bills, because these are things that you have to do before you can even get to the place where
you can buy a home.
Right. Mm-hmm. So what are some of your, would you say, if you are a single person, would you recommend, because there's the debate about condos, first of all, and whether or not you should buy a condo because of the whole condo fees, and the condo fees are normally higher because they abandon.
A lot of people don't pay their condo fees, and then it makes the property not FHA approved. A lot of people apply for FHA loans because you only have to put 3.5% down, whereas a conventional loan you put 20% down. Condos are a touchy subject. Me personally, I like condos.
I do too. Especially
the reason why I like condos as a single person, the reason why I like condos is because you could potentially get it for very cheap. You could potentially get it in for very cheap. I think she left already. And yes, your condo fees are high. I've seen like an astronomical amount of condo fees, but you can always rent those condos out when you're ready to go. You know what I mean? Like, if your mortgage is $1,000, you can potentially rent it out,
For what?
Whatever the market rate is at that point in time. But okay. It's usually, typically, always
Do you more. Feel like you lose money on condos a little bit, though, when you go to rent them out, depending on the whole condo fee situation and stuff like that?
I mean, you would factor that into your rent and what you want to charge them. You would factor your mortgage, your condo fees. Most people that rent out their condos, you don't pay any of the utilities. The tenant pays all of the utilities. So it definitely varies. It's a touchy subject. You just have to, it's all in your financial, what you want to do.
Because I would do a condo, and I actually knew someone that was renting out or getting ready to rent out a condo, but said that it wouldn't be ready till like April or June. But it was like a one bedroom.
I think the thing that people mistaken for condos is just because a condo can look just like an apartment. It's the ownership that makes it a condo. Like, that's what makes it a condo. It's not the structure of the building. It's the ownership of the building.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
A little bit.
So, for example, around Forest Creek, you familiar with the Forest Creek area?
Forest Creek. Okay.
In Forestville, those apartments over there.
Some of those
are condos. because of their ownership.
Like as if somebody bought, because if somebody, somebody bought
that unit.
Yes, that's what.
And now they're renting, you know what I mean? It's, it looks like an apartment. And right. I think a lot of people get that misconstrued, like apartments, houses, townhouses.
Condos.
It's ownership. That's what makes it, that's what makes the structure, whatever, or labelized. You know what I mean? So a condo is nothing but ownership.
Yeah,
it's,
so that's which people buy units.
Right? Yeah, people, like, you can buy a unit.
My sister lives in Naylor Gardens, and someone bought her old unit, and she had to move to a different, you know, building and stuff like that.
So, somebody, that's the,
so now that's considered a condo, even though it's in an apartment building.
Okay. So it's not the structure that makes sense. Okay. That makes it a condo. It's the ownership that makes it a condo.
Okay. And I actually have someone, so this is obviously a topic that people are, you know, the home, whole house and condo. Because actually DJ, hey Dwayne, he's listening and tuning in. He's asking, what's a good area in the DMV to buy a condo?
It's your personal preference. Okay. What's a good area?
Like as far as, because remember what we were just talking about pricing, being abandoned for pricing, you know, stuff where the fees aren't so high because they still people keeping up with the keeping up with the fees and stuff like that.
Really, it's condos everywhere. You can definitely give me your email address.
Yes. There you go.
You know, we can talk.
You see that, Dwayne? She can give you some more information about
it. Really
how you
depends
can.
On where you want to be at.
I'll get you her email.
And what you, you know, personally, you know, because I can say you could go to Forestville right now, buy a condo for $60,000, but you might be like, I don't want to live in Forestville.
Okay.
So that $60,000 condo is not good for you. You know what I mean? So it really, when you're buying
about what
or
you're looking
looking,
for.
It's all about your, this is your investment. So it's not like, what's a good area? I mean, this area is everywhere because Forestville might be fine for me, but it might not be fine for you. You know what I mean? So it's your personal preference. But Dwayne, give me your email and I will definitely contact you.
Yes. Plug, right? Yes. Real quick. Okay, so Mrs. Phillips would like to call in, but she can't at the moment. She's working.
Okay.
I know about that work life too, them later hours. So she's just asking, what's a quick way to bring up your credit score? If you could give
a quick way. I mean, that's really no, I don't know any quick ways to bring it up. I would just say make your debt to make your debt go down. I know that's what, you know.
And do the, so I would say, because I've had to do it, you know, one thing is, and people don't know this, so I hope this is also helping someone. You can actually reach out to the creditors. Like, instead of, sometimes it is good to go to a debt management.
I do have something. I'm sorry.
No, that's okay.
It just came to me. If you're in, like, if your account has went to collections or something like that, like you have an account that's in collections, before you pay that account off, reach out to that creditor and ask them to give you a letter of removal, stating that once you pay off this balance, they will remove it from your credit as if it never even happened. Because you can pay it off, but it's still on your account, so it's still going to affect you negatively because at some point in time it went into collections.
Exactly.
You want to get those collections removed.
Letter of removal.
And so you
want
to call them and, you know, get it in writing, like, hey, I'm about to make this payment. Before I make this payment, I need you to email me something stating that you're going to email all three, not one, not two,
of
but
the
all
credit
three
bureaus.
Of the credit bureaus saying that you will remove this off of my credit before I make this payment. And 9 times out of 10, the creditor wants their money.
Yeah, they do.
Like,
and they'll make a deal for you. Like, if you owe an astronomical amount of money, they will, and especially, like you said, if it's went to the point of collections, because Verizon just did it with somebody I know. You know, it was like her bill was like $700, almost $800, and then they took it down to like $450.
Because
they just wanted to recoup some of their money. So, you know, you can go to them and just say, hey, can we make a deal? I know you want some of your money. But I think that's good what you said, the letter of removal thing, especially when something's gone
to
collections.
Make sure you get a letter of removal. Don't just pay off your collections thinking like, oh, it's going to go away. Unless they, you know, actually report it to the credit bureaus telling them that you paid and to remove it, then it won't get removed. You know, you could dispute it all day.
I've disputed
stuff all day on my credit card.
That's what
it doesn't matter. You still owe it. So you want to
get the letter from the company.
Yeah, from the company.
Okay.
Stating that, you know, they're going to send it off and remove it.
Well, that's good, because I didn't know that you can reach out to the companies directly. I just know when they put something on my credit report, and I was trying to buy a house that time, I literally called the credit bureaus and was like, look, I paid this off already. Like, I can send
you
a copy of my...
the creditor. It comes off quicker when the creditor does it.
When the credit... Okay. All right. Perfect. See, that's good. So, we learning. We learning, everybody out there. So, Mrs. Phillips, thank you so much for tuning in, Miss Lady. We appreciate the support. She was saying that, you know, she used to go through the same thing as far as having to Bill Burton when she was a child. I just want to acknowledge that we saw her comment. So, yeah, that's definitely, this is good stuff. So I'm going to go ahead and throw this call-in number out here for those of you that may be able to call in. Or if you have my personal number or Ashley's personal number, you know, just go ahead and send us a text. Text us your questions or anything that you have. Like she said, we're not credit counselors. But I know for me, I'm coming from the position of having, you know, went through and started the home buying process and knowing the things that I had to do to try to, you know, raise my score, which was, yes, to pay down, you know, some debts, at least to the 30%.
How far are we away from that?
Well, true. And then it's funny because I felt convicted while you were sitting here saying all these other things are excuses. And I'm like, oh, I'm the excuse maker.
I felt like, oh my gosh. Defense mechanisms that we use to stop ourselves from reaching the next level. Just like, you know, you get complacent with a situation and you're just like, I can't move forward. Or you don't want to because you're complacent and you're content in that box. But we're not never going to grow if we always stay complacent and content. At some point in time, like, you just got to be like, okay,
I'm going to do something.
I'm going to see if it works. And if it don't work, then, you know, it wasn't your time. And it's okay. You can try again later. But let's get you out the blocks.
You definitely gonna have to be my agent when I get ready to. I was gonna say you definitely gonna have to be my agent.
Come to see me today.
So the number, everybody, is 301-278-1293. 301-278-1293. And then I also want to, because I never advertise our show, my show, as a Christian show per se, but I am a Christian person, you know. So, and then money. People don't realize this. The Bible references money and finances a lot, you know, because there's a scripture that says that where your heart is, there your treasure will be. Like where your heart is, there your treasure will be also. And the Bible mentions tithes, and my pastor actually broke down the tithing thing. People don't like to talk about that. That'll be a whole nother segment in and of itself as well, as far as tithing in the church and that 10%. And do you have to give it? Should you give it? But really, they said, my pastor was saying that tithing is not so much just about the fact that God wants, the church just wants your money per se, even though you should want to help spread the gospel, and that's one way that you're being a tool of doing that is by giving at least your 10%. But it's more so just that God wants to see if you're going to trust him, because money is normally close to people's heart. People, you know, people go to give you your money, their money, it's an attachment to it, you know. So it's like, I just want to see if you trust me with this much of your heart, you know, by giving the 10% back to me, so, you know, go forth and spread the gospel and such like that. But on another note, there's books and stuff that you can read. I know there's a lady named Michelle Singletary. Have you heard of her, Ashley? Michelle Singletary. She's, I want to say she was like a, in like the Washington Post. Like, I think she had like a, you know, like a segment or something that she did in the newspaper. But I know she's written many books and stuff like that on finances. And then there's a book called, my pastor had us try to read this book called Lee Jenkins on Money. Right. And this is actually a spiritual based book about finances. So again, it's Lee Jenkins. I'm trying to make sure I'm showing it. Lee Jenkins on Money. And I will recommend this. Now, I confess I haven't read the whole book, but I know the few pages that I've read is real deep, because sometimes you just need that knowledge. If you don't have it, you know, you can Google stuff, you can YouTube, there's audiobooks, there's actual books. You know, we spend all this time on social media and, you know, and doing all these other things and watching reality ratchet TV. We can go ahead and give a little bit of time to picking up a book or listening to an audio book or, you know, doing something like that, or just having conversations like we're having now, you know, to try to get more information.
People don't know how to talk. But that's something I said that I was going to start doing, trying to get off of social media so much. Because I promise you, I just be scrolling.
You do.
And liking.
Have you ever taken a little break from it, though?
I haven't.
Okay. Because I will say, once you take a break from social media, it does help you when you finally come back on it. It's like you know how to, like, detach a little bit more. Mm-hmm. You know, because you kind of, I don't know.
I think that's probably, like, one of the first things I do. I check my email so I can reply back to people, and then.
Well, at least you check your email.
I mean, people contact me on social media, Facebook, and Instagram, you know, all of the time for, like, you know, different stuff. So I kind of feel like I have to be on there now. Mm-hmm. And I'm trying to promote a business. I think before, I did used to just sit on social media all day long.
Mm-hmm. Oh, look, you said you do sit on social media all day long?
Like, I used to just sit on there and just be like...
I thought you said you wish you could sit on social media.
No. I used to sit up there and I would literally just sit there and be like... I still do it sometimes. I promise you, there's somebody right now that will probably be like, if she don't put her phone down...
Damn, that's what... Like, people texting you now saying
that? No, but I'm telling you, I just know this one person... That says it to me all of the time. And like
put your phone down.
And I be like,
because when you out with them, you still be on the phone. Yeah, it's a little rude. You know, actually, so just going off subject a little bit now, because people are still commenting, but my niece is actually a certified etiquette consultant. Mm-hmm. Right, and she named her business Lady Lifestyle Brand. And she said that the whole phone thing, especially at the dinner table, is bad etiquette. But like when you're out sitting at the, and then I didn't know that until she said it.
It drives my son's grandparents crazy because I just go sit up and I will sit down at the table and I just be like,
and you,
they're like, push your phone. And I'm like, listen, people,
people,
that's because people don't talk on the phone anymore. We text.
Yeah,
so it's
that's
like
true.
You're being rude. If I can't stand for my text message, just sit out there and linger. Yeah, like.
You're so nice. I'm so the opposite.
Really?
I'm bad with texting, but you know what?
If you text me, you probably getting a reply in like.
Look, I was texting because it's you. If you was just like my sister or somebody, I would have, you know, if it wasn't for us doing this and stuff. Mm-hmm. I'm telling you because my job, it depends on what you do. You know, and you probably have to communicate a lot with your email and stuff.
Yeah.
My job is more, you know, standing on my feet, helping customers and stuff. Okay. So I can't have my phone in that situation anyway. Oh, so I kind of just got out of the habit of being on my phone. And people will get on me all the time. Oh, my gosh. I text you. And then, you know, God forbid the red receiver's on. And I'm really getting bombed out. But it's because I'll, like, look at it, and I'll make a mind to... I'll have in my mind, like, it's like I'll respond in my mind, and then I come back to it later, like, oh, my gosh, I didn't text so-and-so.
Yeah, no,
so.
I'm a responder. I respond really quick.
Oh, that's good. Look, so I'm glad to know. I'm going to say, so when if you guys become my agent and you don't respond to me, then I know something is
going on.
Okay, so this was good though. I'm liking this conversation because, like I said, you told me some stuff that I didn't even know as far as the principle and then the letters you called again for the debt people to take it.
Letter of removal.
Yeah. Look, see, I told you I'm taking my notes. Got my little notes over here. Okay, so let's talk about, because we kind of touched on this off air, you all. So your passion, you work for Long & Foster, mm-hmm. and real estate is your passion.
Yes.
Right. But that's not what you do for your 9-to-5 right now. Do you mind sharing what it is that you do? You can't talk about
it.
Okay. Well, not the company and all that, because we don't want you to know. Well, anyway, everybody.
So they see me, they be like, that's her.
Yeah, we don't want that. Okay,
no,
we
I
want
mean,
you
honestly,
to still be able
saying,
to survive.
Like, I don't, you know, working a 9-to-5 is not something that ultimately I want to do for the rest of my life. It's not my goal in life.
Mm-hmm. I think a lot of people
feel
like that lately, though.
I
think
a lot of people
feel
like that.
Yeah, and everybody, but we all have that thing that I guess we all have to do and I'll continue to do.
Yeah,
because
like I have bills about
we have to, yeah,
you know,
we have to survive.
I have a child to take care of and I'm thankful and I'm blessed that I do have, you know, the means to be able to do that. But ultimately, I mean...
You were right.
Yeah, I mean, you never know who you can help. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
Like, you never know, like, just like in speaking. You know
mm-hmm,
what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And helping
Which, thank
one
you so
person.
Much for speaking. Mm-hmm. And coming on.
Yeah.
This is her first time being on the show, by the way.
Is.
You all. So, she made her radio debut. Reach out to her. Yes. Let's get that information up, Donnell, please, to make sure that people can follow Miss Ashley Brooks on social media. Yes. If you want to, for networking, right? Because you want to do more networking opportunities.
Definitely
want
to get out
speaking,
more networking.
Real estate, you know, you need an agent. Yes, absolutely.
Agent.
Need some help. DJ, hopefully, Dwayne, you still tuning in. Go ahead and add her on Instagram, you know, so that we can definitely, because this is good, though, because it's just getting that information.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that because like you said, some people don't have the time to read it in a book, you know, so just being able to have
and some
access
people just
to that
don't
information.
Know. Like some people's. They don't know.
They just.
I mean, I didn't know until I was. What is my son 9? I didn't know until what 5 years ago.
Okay.
When like my son's father passed away 5 years ago. So five years ago is when
stuff started.
Kind of yeah, like I kind of had a reality check and was like, life isn't la la land.
Mm-hmm.
You can't just be walking around in la la land all the time. Because at any given moment, something can happen and change your whole life. So that's when I actually got a reality check. With him passing was my reality check.
Have you? That would be off. That would be another conversation. Okay, so any suggestions to anybody, especially people who, and this might be another segment now that I'm thinking about it, but for people who want to start their own business, like me and you both, you have your LLC, I have mine. Neither one of us are working it full time just yet, but at least we've, you know, gotten it started. So I would just say to anybody out there, and then you can just add on to this, just baby steps, you know, like just do whatever you feel like you can afford, you know, right now. Like if anybody's out there looking for a logo, I know someone who does really, really good logos, you know, for a not so expensive price. So hit me up, you know, Lexi Sade, LexySade. I don't know if you could put that handle up there, Donnell, or just follow me, Lex and the City Show, you know, and I'll give you her information. It's a female, but she's really, really good. And then I actually went to Baltimore to register my LLC.
That's
where
I was.
And it doesn't cost that much, right? Like, no. People think that it's...
I mean, your tax ID number is free. You can get that on the IRS.
Yeah, the EIN.
Yeah, your EIN number is free. Yes. And once you get that, you can Google articles of organization. You can fill out your article organizations online, print them out, take them down to Baltimore. I think the registration was like what? Like
$300? Yeah. It, altogether, I think it was like $300.
And I mean, it's a sacrifice. And but if you're willing to do it, and I think that's life in general, sacrifices.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, at some time, you have to sacrifice going to the club. You got to sacrifice eating out. You got to sacrifice buying the latest shoe. You got to sacrifice buying the latest outfit just to have something for the future. You gotta not live in that moment for a moment. Don't live in that moment for a moment.
For a moment, yes.
And then, you know, so you can prepare for it.
Yeah, and it'll feel better. Like when I went and filed my LLC stuff, because that was the only thing I could say I really did, like aggressively toward my business last year, I felt so proud, you know?
It's a major
and
step.
You have to celebrate those wins, I'm realizing. Yeah. Like, when you go and do something big, you have to celebrate. Yeah.
I was like, I got my LLC. Even though the LLC hasn't made no money at that point in time when I got it, but it was still the fact, like, look.
You did that. That's a big step. Yeah. You can say that yes. And then once you get those articles, speaking of business accounts, real quick. You can then take that to the bank, and that's how you start your business account.
Yeah.
Like, I started my business account with my credit union, and it's only $100 minimum balance. And
that's it. Credit union are you?
Andrews. Andrews. Oh, with that business, yes.
I'm a capital Andrews. Tell y'all something.
Yeah, it's the fees, and it's for, like, all it just maintain $100.
I think if I have a minimum balance, then it's no fee. But that minimum balance is $900.
Yeah. Oh, it's more. See what I'm saying?
Yes.
See, so now you learn something.
Go to Andrews
and get you a business account for $100, okay? And it's a good one, you know? And then, like she said, the EIN number, that's all you need as far as tax purposes.
Mm-hmm.
Like, once you at least have that tax ID number, and you can start doing little business expenses, even if you don't have a business account, just find somebody that's legit enough to help you get some write-offs.
Yeah. I'll
say that. Because I got a good tax person.
It's this app called Mile IQ. Okay. It's an amazing app.
Mile IQ.
Okay. A lot of agents use it. And if you are an agent,
you have to be an agent?
But I'm just saying, like, we drive everywhere.
Yeah.
So you know, we got to drive from this house to that house, meet this person to that person. It literally, like, you swipe left for personal, you swipe right for business, and at the end of the month, it'll give you, like, a sheet, like a printout that you can take, and, you know, you can balance that up with your tax.
I like that. Okay.
Your gas expenses, and at the end of the year, when you want to write off $10,000 in gas, you actually have
something to prove. Okay.
You
I like that. Okay. And it's free.com, too.
Yeah.
Okay. Because, you know, the app store, I know they try to make y'all pay for everything.
Yeah, that app is actually free.
Okay, good.
But it's a good app. I use it. I like it.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yay. So, see, good information. So, real quick, and he'll probably put it up on the screen as well because we are coming to the end of our show. But thank you so much for whoever has tuned in. I definitely want to refresh right quick just to make sure that we didn't miss any comments. But, Ashley, if you want to go ahead and just share how people can reach out to you real quick and find you and get good information and all that good stuff.
Social media, I'm on Instagram and Facebook. So Instagram is a.brooksestates. So a.brooks estates. And it's the same for Facebook. Again, I'm with Long and Foster. I work out of the Mitchellville office, so I'm not far from, you know, the DMV. The office phone number is 301-249-1600, and my cell phone number is 240-602-5346.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay.
And it was good. And thanks again for my nice gift card. And again, thank you so much for everybody tuning in to Lex in the City Show. Sorry for the people that I didn't get to comment, but Sheree, Mrs. Phillips, Dwayne, you know, Tarisha Gilmore, Fawaz, everybody that's looking and commenting. Thank you so much for tuning in. And we love you. And we hope you have a good night and enjoy the rest of your week. And I hope that you all tune in next Monday for my next female guest.
Bye.